John came to Moscow on invitation of the American Embassy, I believe, and the Union of Soviet Composers. He gave a concert in Moscow, and I was present there. Later he gave another concert on the premises of the Union of Soviet Composers, and that's when we were introduced to each other.
Alexander Grodsky is a singer and composer and author of one of the first Soviet rock operas.
What is the role of a musician in the Soviet Union in the search for peace?
I think that the most important thing is contact, contacts between people. When a musician steps on stage, he uses his art to establish contacts with the audience. And if the musician is being honest and frank,
the public immediately understands that and responds
in an emotional, sincere way. And this happens not just here in the Soviet Union or in the United States, it happens everywhere. And it happens in various genres.
You are perhaps best known at this time in the United States for your collaboration with John Denver. How did that collaboration come about, and what was the process of working together across two cultures?
It happened by chance. John came to Moscow on the invitation of the American Embassy, I believe, and the Union of Soviet Composers. He gave a concert in Moscow, and I was present there. Later he gave another concert on the premises of the Union of Soviet Composers, and that's when we were introduced to each other. So he sang a song, I sang a song, we had a kind of song exchange, and he got interested in my music. We met again, went to a restaurant, had a nice conversation. After which, when we were saying goodbye to each other, we decided to try and make music together, to write a song together or something. At the time, John had a song which he had already recorded called Let Us Begin, or What Are We Making Weapons For? And he had a separate tape of this song with just the accompaniment, without the voices. So we had an idea. If John could come back to Moscow another time and bring this tape, then perhaps he and I could do the vocals, could record the vocals. It was actually his idea. It was a specific proposal that he made, and I immediately agreed, even though it is my rule never to sing other people's songs. So our next meeting was interesting. John flew in from the United States a few hours before we were scheduled to do the recording. And I flew in from Irkutsk in Siberia, where I was touring with concerts. So it's interesting that we came from the opposite ends of the globe, him from the United States, me from Siberia. So we met in Moscow in the recording studio at about 6 p.m. I must say that at the time I did not know the song, neither the lyrics nor the music.
So I had my first glance at the sheet at 6:30. It took me about 30 minutes to master the song, and then we went ahead and recorded it. But at about 8:30 we were done. And then we did the preliminary mixing so that one could listen to it from a narrow tape.
As you think about your music, what is in your mind as you create it?
Frankly speaking, nothing. I don't think of anything when I create music. I would be lying if I were to say that I was thinking of anything.
I
know that in an interview like this, it would probably sound better if I were to say that I have some kind of elevated thoughts or something, but no, I don't think when I make music, it's just a matter of matching what I can do in terms of my vocals with what I need to do in terms of expressing myself. And then, of course, there is a constant concern when you make music is that you don't lose contact with the audience, and that your contact with the audience widens and deepens so that even the most intimate things, signals that you give be understood by the audience, and the mutual involvement of the musician and the audience. This is extremely important, so I kind of have that concern. I have been singing on stage for quite a while, and I know from experience that if you maintain the contact with the audience throughout the show, then whatever I need and want to say with my music and poetry is best understood by the audience. Perhaps I would like to add another observation. I did experience moments of euphoria on stage when I felt absolutely happy, maybe 4 or 5 times in my whole lifetime. And every time it depended fully on the reactions of the audience. There are times when you can't really contact the audience properly, and I see my audience. I'm not using any kind of visual effect, and to just stand there with my guitar. And sometimes I'm aware of the fact that the audience is not fully disposed toward you, and you can't feel fully happy.
Any artist creates within a context of society, and you've described how you create as a person. And I would like you to talk about what it's like to create spontaneously as you do within the era of glasnost.
You know, glasnost and perestroika have not really brought any changes into my life. I did not need perestroika from the point of view of my creative work. I think that perestroika is needed by those people who don't work well. I've always worked well. And so I didn't need this kind of restructuring that people are talking about nowadays. On the other hand, there is this notion of critical mass. In nuclear physics, they talk about critical mass. When the critical mass is reached, then some major unexpected changes are possible and things can fall apart and so on. I have been working for a long time, and for years, it wasn't possible for me to get published. Up to this day, in most media, there is this attitude toward my work that I'm unpublishable. There's only one recording company that has published my work. So I kept working, writing music, believing that if I'm true to myself, if I'm an honest musician, and if I do good work, then time will inevitably come when the boil will break and the critical mass will be reached, and I will be able to express myself fully and freely. I'm comparing it with a boil that grows. I'm creating this boil, and it grows, and it's coming to a point when it will break, and the energy will be released. I'm sure that even perestroika and glasnost had not begun, I would still have reached this breaking point and be able to express myself fully, but certainly the moment would have come later, maybe 5-7 years later. As I understand it, reactionary bureaucrats in our cultural sphere, people who are responsible for the control of cultural life, decided at some point that it would be more harm if they banned my work, my appearances, than if they allowed me to sing. So they were afraid of scandal in case I were completely banned, and so they decided to give me a little freedom. Frankly speaking, it is a principle for me to avoid any kinds of scandal. I'm a serious musician, a serious poet. I don't need cheap popularity. I don't need scandals which would advertise me. And that is exactly why I was always avoiding Western media in Moscow, because the media needs scandal. They thrive on scandal.
Your collaboration with John Denver has made you very well known in this country. And there's a fellow musician whose career overlapped with yours, who is beginning to get known here, much more in the musical underground. Vysotsky, how was his career different from yours?
I'm quite different from Vladimir. I'm first and foremost a musician.
Я в большей степени музыкант всегда был.
I'm primarily a musician. Of course, you can say that it's really not a big distinction if you write poetry and write music for poetry and then sing your music, then those shades of difference don't matter much. We started making music at about the same time, even though he was 10 years older than me. I started writing my music when I was 14, and that was about 2-3 years after he started writing his music. When Vysotsky died, it had a major impact on me. I had always thought of myself as a person not much concerned about the social problems of everyday life. After Vladimir died, something important changed in me.
Мне показалось,
he was a social critic.
Никто больше в нашей стране не может
he
и не смеет
had
говорить
the guts
критично
to
со сцены.
Say critical things about our life from stage, and to speak openly about pressing problems. And after he died, I had an impression that there was nobody around who had the guts to do this kind of work, and I thought that perhaps it was my duty to start doing that, the kind of work that he did when he lived. And it was also at about the same time that in my own work I reached a different stage. Before, I was thinking more about the form of my music. And I began to focus more and more on the content, on the ideas which I convey
with my music.
К этому времени это подоспело. И с этого момента
it is from that moment
начал довольно смело себя вести на сцене.
I began to behave more boldly on the stage, and my audiences began to grow rapidly to 15,000, 20,000 people at a concert. Then the great poet and singer Vladimir Vysotsky died, and I wrote a song in his memory. And once I performed that song, the authorities immediately got interested in what I was doing because they didn't like my song, and I became involved in a controversy concerning my repertoire. But I continued to write and sing songs that I wanted, and as far as the Vysotsky song, I'm still singing it. That's a song which is part and parcel of my repertoire.
И единственное только что, может быть, мне больше повезло, чем другим, потому что
perhaps I was luckier than others because I graduated from the opera department.
Я учился на факультете композиции Московской консерватории, и у меня всегда были аргументы против дурака, чисто музыкальные аргументы.
Purely musical arguments against fools.
Я не пью, я не наркоман, я не курю, и очень сложно было меня обвинить в аморальности, поэтому все обвинения газетные, которые были, они были, они были просто до того смехотворны, что в них просто никто не верил.
So it was difficult for them to attack me.
Но при этом это была все-таки только одна сторона деятельности. Я много очень делал музыки в кино. Я сделал свою первую картину с Михалковым Кончаловским в 1974 году.
Quite a lot. My
это
first film, for which I wrote music, came out in 1974, directed by Mikhalkov Kончаловский, Romantic Story of Lovers. After that, I have written music for about 25 movies, wrote several operas and ballets, and about 300 songs. I'm now working on my 11th album, a personal album, songs which I have written and performed, and this album is based on the work of the great Russian-American author Vladimir Nabokov.
As you project ahead, what further changes would enhance your ability to create to the fullest? You've described how you create, and you've described the tension between you and the organized society. And you've also said it's changed. So at this point, what further changes do you need for it to be the best possible creative arrangement for you?
I'm completely free and open in my work. I haven't done anything in my professional life that I'm ashamed of. In my personal life, of course, I have made mistakes, I think, but not in music.
В музыке нет, ибо человек часто попадает в ситуацию, в которой ему нужно быстро принять решение, и он может ошибиться, и сказать что-то не так, и сделать что-то не так, и за это ему потом будет стыдно.
And you feel ashamed afterward. If you make music, if you write music, you take a long time before you produce something. So you have to be true to yourself. Otherwise, you're a hypocrite.
Thank you very much for sharing with us today your insights into the role of music in a changing society and your own creative approach to music.